Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Dave Parker from Codefellas.
I was worried about the questions there right at the end.
Yeah.
Set?
Yep.
So, hey, everybody, thanks for letting me stand in. I'll be talking to you tonight about Vacasa. Let me know what I can answer for you. Mostly their cap table and their tax prep, so I can help you with all those things.
So, well, first, just thanks for being here.
Yeah, absolutely.
Short notice. It was funny. I, from about 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock, I was like, well, I'm going to have some problems getting him up here. So I was like sitting out feverishly. Friends, emails, So thanks for picking it up.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's great. What's funny is what this is it's truly just a fireside chat. It's really just two people talking about, I've started several companies, so I have a lot of questions that some of you have or have had. So I've never interviewed Dave. I've known Dave for 3 or 4 years, and I've never interviewed Dave. We've done some kind of mock interviews before, but never a real true interview. So I was looking forward to that, so I'm glad we're doing it. So what this is, we'll have about a 45-minute interview, and then we'll last 15 minutes or so. We'll do Q&A, so just hold your questions to the end, but feel free to ask any questions you want. I already know that he'll answer anything that you want to ask him, so feel free to just bring those up at the end. So welcome, Dave. Thanks for being here.
Thanks.
So give us some, because you've been lucky enough or unlucky, depending on if your wife wants to tell you that, being involved in several startups, what are the things that keep you moving? What keeps you wanting to keep doing it? I mean, you became CEO, what, a year ago?
19 months ago for Codefellas.
Yeah, Codefellas,
so,
okay.
Second company I've ever taken over versus everything else has been ones I've founded myself.
Sure. So What keeps you going? What keeps the juices flowing for Dave Parker? What's the?
Well, I think there's a little bit. I don't know how you are all relative to the startup thing. I can't not do it, right? My wife calls it the sickness, right? So I'm like, if you have an idea and you're like, Dave, you should be excited about my idea. I could be excited about your idea for a little while, and then your idea would bore me to tears. But my ideas I always like, and some of them are crap, by the way, right? Some of them are really great. And some of them, and I always tell my team, 50% of my ideas are good and 50% are bad. And we need to figure out which one this is, because you never know. So I think that whole like building things, innovating, and then also doing well by doing good. I'm at a point in my career that I've had both successes and failures. But now it's really kind of about, hey, can I really change the world? Because that would be good. And if it was just about money, then that's really not that interesting. And those ones are hard, right? To find something that you're like, it really does have a big vision and something we really want to do. So one of the things I worked on before I came to Codefellas was I helped run programs for Startup Weekend. So it was Up Global was the parent company, so we should have had that logo for us too.
Yeah.
And we did in 2014 about 1,200, over 1,200 events worldwide in 120 countries. So anybody been to a Startup Weekend before? Awesome, some of you. Some of you are like, I have no idea what a Startup Weekend is. So in 2014, we did over 1,200 events with 75,000 attendees in 120 countries. And 65% of those events were outside the U.S. And the idea of a Startup Weekend is you show up Friday night, you pitch your idea, you try to convince a team of people to join you, and then launch a demo by Sunday, right? So that's the whole like methodology to the madness. And I was fortunate enough there to get to join a movement in progress. So I don't think any of us would ever go, hey, let's start a movement, right? It's like, versus let's start a company or start a nonprofit. But so there I got a chance to work on a movement, which was fun too. So that was kind of you look at the trajectory of those things. Some of them started with ideas, some of them started with purpose, and now there's kind of a blend of the two.
Yeah, yeah. And when you find the one that has purpose, what are the things that, for Dave Parker, what are the things that make you say, this is why I'm going to do it? Is it because it's something you've done in your past? Is it because it's, your brother did this or whatever? I mean, what's the thing that just, again, that kind of turns your light switch on and says, this is why I'm going to do this thing. What is it?
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I was at a venture conference a couple months ago, and somebody was talking about economics and the state of the country and blah, blah, blah. And regardless of what side of it you're on, one of the speakers was like, you know, entrepreneurs see down economic times as a great chance to start a business. And I'm like, that's total bullshit, right? Because us as entrepreneurs are like, I have an idea I can't not do. And, you know, more startups got started during the recession than probably any other decade in recent times, right? So it was like, was it because the price of real estate was cheaper that we started a startup? No, that had nothing to, like, external factors had very little. It had to do with that internal drive of like, I have this thing and it's a problem. And the first couple of companies were like, I'm not sure they were, in retrospect, knowing what I know now, would I have done them? No. And I say that in light of the first one went from 0 to $32 million in sales in 5 years. But knowing what I know now, I would never have done that company again.
Yeah.
So there's a little bit of the I can't not do it, but it really is around a problem solution set. For some of my friends, it's not problem solution, it's like entertainment, right? So there's a big difference between like, are you solving a problem, and a buddy of mine makes games, and he's like, we don't solve a problem, we just make games.
Yeah.
So you're waving back there. $32 million, yeah.
Can you talk about what was the turning point?
I will do that after Mike's done with his questions. I'm happy to have that be the first question. How's that? Okay.
So when you take, you know, let's say it's year one, you've got your idea, you've vetted it at some level, it's somewhat,
we hope it's good.
You hope it's good,
yeah.
Right? You never really know, but you hope it's kinda good. So when you've got it there at that stage, what are the steps that you take to kind of make sure that it works so you could actually scale it? Like, you know, because that's like, especially when I talk to a lot of people, it's like, yeah, I've got an idea, it's starting to work. Like, how do I know it's good enough to go to the next level versus just being kind of, you know, a lifestyle business versus a, you know, a scalable business?
Yeah.
What are those steps you need to get to?
So today I would look at it as from the investor perspective. I kind of have that. In Seattle, I probably invest in a couple deals a year, which I am a founder entrepreneur, not an investor. Regretfully, being a 2x investor a year makes me an active angel in Seattle, which is kind of sad. So the thing I always look at it is it a big market? Like, is there really a good substantial opportunity to be more than a lifestyle business? Can it be something really interesting and large? Is it a growing market or is it a market in decline? Like, I have one friend who buys businesses that are just businesses in decline, and he just rides them as long as he can. And I'm like, I don't even know how you do that, right? I mean, it's just like, it befuddles the mind, right? But he makes a good living at it. So is it a big market? Is it a big opportunity? Is it growing as a business? And then can I bring something unique to it that's really a competitive advantage, right? And typically, if you are in tech, that really just means speed. Like, do you have knowledge of the customer and speed to market that's faster than anybody else? Because the whole like concept of sustainable competitive advantage in tech is really just BS. So, because if you have a patent and you filed it, and I look at your patent, I can kind of reverse engineer your patent and do it slightly differently and be faster than you. So, so those are the things I look at today. It's like, is it a unique idea, big market? Do I like the team? Like, are there people there I want to believe in or not? If anybody is thinking about doing a business and you're considering one of the big topics is timing, Bill Gross, who from Idea Lab, probably did the best 7 minutes on the internet on a TED Talk about startups and timing, and it was a brilliant 7-minute TED Talk, and I would encourage you to review that. And he brings up similarly, you know, team, market, traction, business model, which I'm super geeky about business models, mostly because I've done some of them wrong, and market timing. So those are things that I think are really important. But as I look at the idea myself, it's like, is it something I want to give a significant portion of time of my life to? Right? So anybody here from OfferUp? How long ago did OfferUp get started?
5.
Probably a little more. Could be a little more. Do you know? Not sure. I was just trying to say, welcome. Wow. Okay, our new person. Most startups are, the math is it's 8 years to some form of exit. So if you're successful, you're an 8-year overnight success story, because for the first 6 years, nobody hears about you. And the last 2 years, like, they're amazing. Yeah, exactly. And you're like, yeah, 8 years ago was amazing. So is an idea you really care about and you're super passionate about. Passion is important, but passion is not adequate, right? Because you can passionately lose a lot of money, and there's nothing that's worse than being a zombie startup, which is, especially when you're the founder, because you can't leave, especially if you took outside investment money. That really sucks. So you're like, I have this zombie startup that never dies and isn't going to live. That's a bummer place to be, right? Maybe produce a decent lifestyle business.
Yeah.
And by lifestyle business, by the way, the definition is it creates a lifestyle for you and your family or maybe some employees, but no one's ever going to buy the business, right? There's no, if you exit, the business is done, right? So yeah. My CPA, for example, no offense to CPA firms. Well, as a small service provider is different than being part of a firm, right? Because when you have a book of business, and if you're not there to deliver it, it's tough.
Yeah, yeah. Right? His business is only as good as he is.
Yep.
Yeah. So when you're in that, because the tough part for most startups is getting from first customer to, or not first customer, first paying customer.
Right.
I quote that, first paying customer, say, to the next maybe 100 paying customers. That learning period that happens there is very hard, because you can get one or two paying customers because probably some of your friends, but it's harder to get people that are not your friends and to pay you money for your product. So what are some things that entrepreneurs can look at to help figure out getting from the first paying customer to, say, let's just say the 100th paying customer?
Yeah.
What are some things that would help them get that far?
So let me unpack it for you, kind of the way I would think about it today. If you were a friend and coming to me over coffee and asking kind of this question of, like, I'm getting ready to leave my day job. Before I do, what should I know? Right. So, and my goal with that is, okay, before you spend $200,000 and all of your savings and your 401k and sell your house, then spend $2,000. And before you spend $2,000, spend $200, right? And I would start at the $200 multiple and then work your way up, right? So this is before you leave your day job. And by the way, this has happened. I could tell you the name of the person. It's painful because you're like, don't leave your day job. And he's like, I already did. And I'm like, you need to go get your day job back, because this idea is bad. And it's not that you're bad, just so you know. The criticism is not about you. And anybody seen the new Geico commercial with the sumo guy on the ice skates, and he does the little bird move?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I have news for you. This is your little bird.
Yes.
And when it's the only idea you have, you won't kill it, even though it's a bad idea. And you talk to people who know you, like Mike, and Mike's like, I know that was English, and I know what you just told me was in a sentence structure, but I have no idea what the hell you're talking about. And you're like, he just doesn't like me. No, your idea sucks. And people don't get it. And if people consistently don't get it, it's the idea. And you need to ask yourself the hard questions about it. So I would flip it around and say, if I was going to spend my first $200, yeah, what I would want to know is, I'm going to go out and talk to everybody I can talk to about the idea. And if nobody gets it, I'm going to be like, note to self, nobody gets it. Am I explaining it poorly or not? And then I would ask people around me for really hard ideas, like, do you get it? And some of your friends are going to be like, so the classic, my first company was like, my mom was like, I don't know what you do, and it's okay. And I'm like, no, it's not okay. You need to, I mean, like, if you don't understand, it's kind of a problem, actually. So do people get it? Can you go buy traffic in AdWords on Google? Is anybody searching for what you're looking for? If nobody's searching for what you're looking for, you may have solved a brilliant problem that nobody cares about. So go spend a couple $100, see if anybody's buying into those AdWords. If nobody's buying those AdWords, I'd say that was a cheap lesson in getting out of an idea quickly. If people are buying it, I'd spend a couple $1,000. I'd build an MVP, minimum viable product, right? I'd build a PowerPoint version of it with design. I would show somebody my product using the arrow button and say, doesn't it do amazing things? Look, it's amazing. And I would get their reaction to it before I actually built a product. And if people said, that's amazing, I need that. Like, again, this is where the analogy is, an investor will say, is it a pain pill or is it a vitamin? Do I have to have it? Or it's like, meh. By the way, meh, if you're a startup, is bad. Right? This is where you walk away from a meeting with a venture capitalist and they went, you should stay in touch. And you walk away and you're like, they really dug my idea. No, they did not. This is Seattle. They're Seattle nice.
Yes, Seattle nice.
So if you come up with a better idea later, they're like, yeah, we met you 2 years ago and you had a really shitty idea. And I said, stay in touch. And if you get traction, you should talk to me. Because that's what VCs in Seattle do. Because there's only three of them, right? So yeah, if somebody gives you the meh answer, that's not good. That's bad. So then the thing I would ask you is to turn on your head and say, if I was to kill this idea, how would I kill it? Right? If the idea was going to die, how would it die? And then I would leave my day job. So after I did those steps, then I would leave my day job. But until then, I wouldn't leave my day job.
Yeah.
So there's a lot you can moonlight with and do side projects to figure out whether anybody cares about your idea or not before you're like, I have to show my commitment to go be full-time entrepreneur. I'd test those ideas out first.
Yeah, you can buy Facebook ads.
Totally cheap.
As if you had a product and they'll tell you.
Yeah, and by the way, on that note, I just tested something and I wrote a long blog post about a step-by-step guide for how to do this. I literally stood up a new site during the first half of a Seahawks game, put up a commerce site, put up a product, tested AdWords for 2 days at $100. There was no product to buy. Okay. People are like, oh my gosh, you're going to disappoint your customers. No, I'm not. I have no product to buy. So I'm going to buy traffic. I'm going to get them to a landing page, and I'm going to go, sorry, we're not ready to ship our product yet. But what did I discover? I knew what my cost per click is. I know what my conversion ratio is, and I know if I can drive people to a site. Wow, what if I disappointed some customers? They had no product to buy anyway, yeah. Right? So just testing it out.
Yeah, it's worth to do that for sure. And in that process of determining, you know, determining if the product has any fit at all, right? what would you tell me if I was like, so I've got my product market fit, I've got people, I've figured out that for 21 cents I can get someone to get to my site and
yep.
view this thing that doesn't actually exist, right? What are you gonna, I mean, what do I need to do at that point? Do I need to building out all these features and start talking to customers? And what happens at that point with that product? Is it just give them exactly what I think is right? Where do I go there to get to the next step?
So a couple of directions I would take you at that point is like, okay, I have a product. There's traffic there. People are starting to convert. So you need to answer a back of the napkin math question, which is called unit economics. So the concept of unit economics is there's a cost to build a product, right? So I have to have developers or whoever's building the product for me to sell, or if I'm importing it, we talked about earlier. So there's a cost of building it. There's a cost of selling it, which I know for your engineers in the room are like, what? It's a brilliant mousetrap. People will find it. No one needs to sell it. There's a cost of selling it. That's called customer acquisition cost, or CAC, right? And then there's the reasonable profit that you expect for making a living doing what you're going to do. So let's just say, from a simple perspective, your product retails at $100. So the math's not going to be the same, but call it $33.33 just for now, right? So you want to make $34 in profit, $33 to acquire a customer, and $33 to make the product, just to make it simple. So the question is, now that I know I have a product, people are showing interest in it, how much does it cost to acquire a customer? So what are the unit economics on that? So if I have to buy traffic on Google, or somebody has to sell it, but what's the CAC, right? And then the next question is, what's the lifetime value, or LTV? So if you look at the CAC to lifetime value calculation, it has to be greater than 5 to 1. My LTV has to be greater than 5x my cost of customer acquisition. If it's less than 5x, I would look at it and go, don't leave your day job. Lifetime value is how much the customer is worth over however long you keep them. So if it's a monthly recurring subscription cost, right? So in the case of OfferUp, and I don't know your guys' numbers, but I'll speak to OfferUp since we're here. In the case of OfferUp, I come and buy something on OfferUp, and then I come and buy something again and again. How often am I on the site? How many transactions will I make? In a mature business, you can calculate that value over 36 months. In your business, you should calculate it over 12 months. So a bad business, for example, is somebody that if it costs me $50 to acquire a customer and I make $40 in revenue for every time I sell a customer, that's you're upside down, right? But if it costs me $50 to acquire a customer, I need to be a $250 value, a lifetime value, that revenue that comes in to do that. And that revenue then would pay for a third to build the product, a third to sell the product, and a third to create the profit that you need to have a sustainable business. It makes sense from kind of a basic math perspective, but think 5 to 1, right? So if I can get traffic to my site, now I'm at conversion numbers, right? 1,000 people on my site, how many people register? Of the people who register, how many will buy? What's my conversion numbers? That gives me my costs to acquire a customer. And then how much can I charge for the product? And most founders will just start too low, because conceptually we're like, oh, it was not good when I shipped the first version, so I'll make it cheap. Right, and then raising price over time becomes a little bit harder. You can always lower price. Raising prices are sometimes are difficult.
Sure. And so, tell us a story or something that a real thing that happened to you, one of your earlier companies that was something that was a very big surprise for you as an individual, but maybe a bigger surprise for the company. Like, give us some stories that you went through.
Which one do you want? okay, so quick some data points. So 5 startups of my own, sold 3, closed 2. Reasonable math for startups. Been a CEO a couple times in addition to that. I've managed through 9 transactions, so 6 sell-side transactions, 3 buy-side transactions. Not an investment banker, just an operator. So some of those I made money on, some of those I didn't. So until you're like, what was your exit valuation? How much money have you raised? I've raised about $15 million, exited about $50 million enterprise value. The drawback is sometimes your enterprise value doesn't come to you as a founder, just so you know, just so we're clear. Talk to the accounting firm about preferences.
Yes.
So let's talk about just having your corporate stuff right and understanding what you're in for. So how you sell shares of the company, right? So if we start a company, by the way, 50-50 is the only wrong decision
you go to ever make.
You,
yes.
If you're, yeah, 50-50 is wrong. So if Mike and I start a company,
somebody's 51.
Somebody's 51.
Yeah.
Because
even if we have to draw straws.
I don't, Rochambeau, rock, paper, scissors, I don't care how you get to it. But if 50-50 means the first hard decision that you face, you kick the can on. So then you show up at an investor's door and you're like, hey, well, we're 50-50 partners. I'm like, I know what you do with hard decisions now. You kick the can, you don't make them, right? So 51-49, right? So now when you take investor money, we're not selling our shares. We're creating new shares out of the air. So because that's the way you file your incorporation documents. And we sell new shares that dilutes us down. So if we sell 25% of the company, right, then we get diluted by 25%. So now we hold 75% at roughly 50-50, and somebody bought 25% of your shares. But knowing what you're getting into and doing the corporate stuff right from the start is incredibly important. Deals flip because you do them wrong. Deals flip because your accounting's not right. So you get to be creative about lots of things about your business. Your idea is unique to you. I have good news for you. The GAAP accounting way of accounting it is not unique to you. You don't get to make up your own terms. The accountants get to tell you how everybody else looks at it. There are 9 basic financial and business models. That's it. Your idea is unique. There's 9 models.
You'll fit in one of those boxes.
Right? And you're going to have metrics that are relevant to that model. So if you're doing a marketplace, cool. You have metrics. If you're doing a software as a subscription, awesome, there are metrics. But everything about your business model has a set of predictable numbers. You don't get to be like, we're going to convert at 1,000% better than everybody else in our industry. No, you don't. You're just delusional, and you don't know yet. So there's metrics out there you need to know. So taking care of basic housekeeping stuff, don't be cheap and have your uncle incorporate for you and doesn't know anything about a C-Corp. right? So just, it's not that expensive to do it right the first time. Do it right the first time.
Did that actually happen to you? Is that what you're saying?
Oh, shit, yeah. So, I mean, I've seen clusters of cap tables, and so there's this thing called a waterfall when you do calculations when you go to sell a company, and there's things called preferences. So if you take, if we're 5149 and we take an A round of funding, the A round gets paid before the common round gets paid. If you take a B round of funding, the B round will have a preference and it gets paid before the A round gets paid. Sometimes those preferences are highly dilutive to the founders if you're below a particular price point. Those are expensive lessons to learn. One of the things your accounting firm is going to tell you is when we incorporate, they're going to tell you to file what's called an 83B election, which sounds super stupid right now. But it starts the clock ticking on capital gains tax instead of regular income tax. So when you go to sell your company, you're going to be taxed at 18 or 20%, whatever the going rate is, who knows what it's going to be this next year, versus 35 or 38%. So doing those little things right by talking to a professional is a super cheap lesson, because getting taxed at the higher rate when you're expecting, you're doing the math and you're like, woohoo! And you're like, what? That's a bummer.
Yeah. And so, you know, you can't build a company without being with other people. Mm-hmm. It's quite hard. It's just you have to have people around you, whether they're your co-founders or whether they're your employees or whatever. Give me some good stories of times that you probably made an error in that, and what was the outcome?
Yeah, I mean,
How do you fix it? Like,
co-founder stuff. Yeah, co-founder stuff is the worst.
Yeah.
So three of us decide we're going to work on a new startup idea together. You have expectations. I have expectations. They may be unstated. They're still there. You're going to spend more time with this person than you're going to spend with your spouse, just so you know. So I have a blog post I wrote about awkward co-founder discussions, and it's a two-part process of having a discussion. Part one is we sit down with a beer and talk about where are you in life, and if you're 51 and I'm 49 and we have to put $10,000 in, are you in? And Mike's like, well, I can take money out, but I'm not really up for taking money in. Okay, well, so you're taking money out, I'm putting money in, you're taking it out. Are we staying at 51.49?
That doesn't seem cool.
Well, yeah, because we said 51.49. What? Wait a second. So kind of where you are in life and that whole part of the discussion of like, hey, we have to put money in together. Are we pro rata or not? If this doesn't work, are you giving your shares back? By the way, that's called a reverse. There's a vesting schedule and there's a reverse vesting schedule. If I leave and have 49% and Mike needs to hire somebody to replace me, he needs my shares back. And if I'm not there, I didn't deserve them. And if you're a new founder and that offends you, just so you know, the last deal I raised money with where I was the founder, the venture fund asked me to put a reverse vesting schedule and I was the majority shareholder and founder. And the reason was simple. If you have to replace me, for whatever reason, those shares need to be accessible. You know, 3 years in, I'm like, I'm done, I'm gonna take a job. Well, some of those shares are coming back. Should you be offended that the investor asked? You should grow up and know what investors are gonna ask for. Because you have an opinion, investors have a checkbook. If you have data and customers and traction, you can get to their checkbook. But without that, you just have to learn that that's the math and how things get done in the venture world. So, by the way, raising funds is not a sign of success, just so you know. So revenue is a good sign of success. Yeah. Customer acquisition is a great sign of success. Raising capital isn't necessarily, that's a vanity metrics of vanity metrics. So
it is quite often used as the key, right?
It's a proxy for success,
yes,
but it is not an actual proxy.
Yeah. So in the hiring and firing process, in your opinion, what are the things that most mistakes come from? Where do most of those mistakes come from in hiring people or firing people and just building the team? I mean, when you're building, if it's just you and I and we're hiring our first employee, I mean, that's a third of the company right there. So I mean, they're pretty important. So give us some hints on what you've done in the past of like just hiring these early people, right?
Yeah. And so your company culture is going to be pretty well set by the time you get through four or five people. It's there. right? So how you interact, the norms with which you interact with other people, what's acceptable and not acceptable. There's a whole bunch of unwritten rules in every relationship. Companies are no different. And 4 to 5 people in, it's set. So if you screw it up, by the way, the first one, getting your early question, what was the challenge of growing from 0 to 150 people in 4 years? The first set of people were the people I knew, right? It was like, oh, I can finally get, oh, you're in, right? And I knew who I was hiring. And then we got to the next ring of people, and I'm like, I don't know you. I hope you're good. She says you're awesome. Right? But when we're hiring at a super fast pace, putting in the discipline to hire slowly, fire quickly, is really, really hard. And not having a cult of personality around the CEO or you as the founder or the founding team, when we got to about 75, 80 people, we had this whole introduction of middle management, and the people who had been there since the early days still wanted to talk to Dave. And they're like, yeah, yeah, I'll listen to you, but I want to talk to Dave. Totally was messed up. And it was my fault, right? I mean, you want to look around and point your finger and go, ha ha, there's the three fingers pointing back at me. I'm the problem. And the sooner you recognize that and find a organizational development specialist, in outside of business, we call them therapists, by the way, or personal coaches, we still call them therapists. Because the dysfunction that you're creating in the organization is caused by you. So to change that culture is a very deliberate effort. So coming in as a CEO to a company whose culture is basically set, that's at least a year to a 2-year process to change the culture of the organization. Is super difficult to do. You can do it, but you just needed to be aware of it kind of from the start of like, what culture do you want to create? So part of that awkward co-founder conversations is having that conversation over a beer with your co-founders. By the way, more than 3 is bad. 50-50 is bad. What else? There's a bunch of other stuff that's bad too. duplicate roles and responsibilities, generally not great. But having those discussions early about, hey, what's important to you about the organization? Are we like, we're totally willing to be blunt with each other, or do we have to be kind of Seattle passive aggressive? Right? So like setting those cultural norms and having that discussion is really hard, but you need to do it up front.
Yeah. And what has been your, tell us the story of the first time you fired someone.
Ugh. How many of you, okay, I'm not going to ask. So when I wake up in the middle of the night and I'm grinding my teeth and thinking about somebody, that's generally not a good sign. Now, it could be self-fulfilling prophecy. Right? It could totally be self-fulfilling prophecy. And it could be that the reptilian brain is pretty accurate and knows you should fire them. Early days of doing that, I'm like, oh, no, I can help them. I can fix them. I can make them a contributing member of the organization. And now I just fire them. And somebody's going to be like, wow, that was really harsh. No, what I found, generally speaking, is if I wake up thinking about somebody and grinding my teeth about it, I already know. I'm just waiting for them to catch up or everybody else to catch up with me or whichever it is. But I generally know. So one of the things we do now is we do a 30, 60, 90 review. And you're like, oh, dude, that's a lot of overhead. Yeah, it's a lot of overhead. But if I'm going to fire him, I'm going to fire him fast. So I have very clear expectations, right? If you look at all the HR that talks about people need motivation to do something that's important, they want to feel like they're contributing, they need clear goals and expectations. Yes! So let's make sure we have clear goals and expectations in the first 30 days. And in 90 days, we're going to do a formal review. And the formal review is go kick ass and keep your job. And if you're not kicking ass, then we're going to ask you to leave. Sometimes I know that in 30 days. Don't have to wait 90. You can make it right then. and those decisions never get any easier, by the way, because people's, what's that?
What's the 60?
60 just has a different set of goals and objectives and integration. I figure for, depending on the role in the company, in the first 30 days, we're going to figure out whether they're a cultural fit. In the 60 days, depending on the role, for example, in dev, the first 30 days, you're probably not going to commit code. But in 60 days, we're going to know, like, can you commit code at a reasonable pace? Or if you're in sales, can you make the traction work? But at 90, we're going to know if all of those things are starting to fire on all, and whether you're really a cultural fit to the organization or not. Because if you're not a cultural fit to the organization, we're in denial of a long-term problem. So just one of the things that now is the way I approach it now.
And how did you learn how to fire fast and hire slow?
Well, yeah, I mean, if you take all the mistakes that you'd make from the first set of orgs.
Is there something that you would recommend or something? Like, how do you... Because, I mean, now, after doing several companies, I understand that. But it took me a while to get that figured out in my head that you know, when you know it's wrong, just...
Yeah. I think one of the challenges early on, especially if your idea is fuzzy, then you tend to look around the organization and go, well, it's not really that person's fault that they're not successful here because we were kind of fuzzy with our idea. And now we're clear about our idea, and they're still not a fit, and you give them another 90 days, and then all of a sudden they're there for a year, and you're like... Why is that person still here? So I think you have to deal with the reality of the fact that, hey, you generally will know, and they have to be look at a contributor. You don't have that. Your organization isn't large enough to hide somebody. You're going to be 250 plus people. At 250, yeah, you could make a special projects job for that person, who's a cousin of a co-founder, right? But at 3, 4, 10, 25 people? Nah. There is no room on either your cap table or your balance sheet for that expense. And if they're not a super productive member of your team, then you need to just help them find a place they can be successful somewhere else. And I generally mean that. Help them find a place they can be successful somewhere else.
And what is, at least in your opinion, what's the hardest piece of finding the right fit? You know, go back to that scenario. It's us two. We're hiring our first person. What are some parameters? What's the hard part about finding our first employee? What's the hard part, do you think, that people should really understand that?
Well, the first question is do you know what you're asking them to do? So if you're hiring a developer in, and Mike's the business guy and I'm the developer and we're hiring our first developer, do we know what product we're really trying to ship? Right. So the worst possible scenario, by the way, for an early stage startup is you hire a salesperson with a Rolodex. Anybody even remember what a Rolodex is? So hiring a salesperson too early is really bad. And the reason it's bad is because salespeople are best, and I'm talking salesperson here, a salesperson is best when they can go hunt something and kill it. Sorry for the violent analogy. But they need to, like, they've got to go be productive, got to go knock something down, got to go make a sale, got to go close it. If you stick a salesperson in a room for 90 days and have them whiteboard something while we're trying to figure out what we're going to ship, they become your VP of sales, and they focus on strategy, which means they don't really want to get out the door and go sell shit again. They want to focus on strategy because they've been focused on strategy for 90 days. You need somebody to go knock something down and, like, close a deal. So hiring that person too early is really bad. It's bad because they won't be successful and you don't have a product to ship. So I'd say, you know, knowing that the two of us can look at it and say, when are we really going to ship this? Okay, if we're going to ship this in 120 days, then what do we need between now and 120 days to really make that work? Do we need a social media person? Oh, but I know somebody and they're awesome.
They're so good.
So give you some advice my first CFO's dad gave me. The right thing at the wrong time. Still the wrong thing. And that advice has been so true, I can't even tell you. It's just like, it's been so freaking true. And I'm like, oh, this person's amazing. I'm like, do we have a job opening for them? No. But they're amazing.
Still no.
Still no. Yeah. Right? So I'm going to defer on something I actually need now so I can get the right person at the wrong time. Your organization is not big enough for that. And you don't have enough latitude. Unless you're willing, you want to write more checks, you can write more checks. That's always okay. I would discourage you from doing that. So right person, right time. Don't hire too far in front of it. And frankly, I would hire behind it. If somebody's like, we're swamped in customer service and customer success and we have too many leads. Rockin'. Awesome. We can finally hire another salesperson. We can't get to everybody fast enough. Great. Right? So if you have so much demand that people are like upset about it, what a quality problem you have, right? And versus like, we need to go raise money so we can do this. No, go do the other stuff first and then talk about raising money. So I was on a board call with an early stage company. I'm on the board, which is not in this area. And like, we need to build this new feature. I'm like, just focus on revenue. But we need to build this new feature because people want it. I'm like, stop talking to them then. Just go sell what you have to sell today. I don't know if you guys have noticed this about human nature, but if you go out and talk to a customer and say, we have this thing today, you can buy it, but we have this really cool thing coming, they will wait. You're like, I can't understand why they didn't buy it, because you told them to wait on the new feature set that you're going to ship some future date, right? So go sell what you have to sell today, close that transaction, go make some money on it, and then start to build a feature. Stop talking about new features, right? Just ship what you have to ship today, go sell it, see if people want it. If they don't buy it, then you may have to ship something later, right? But you need to go, it's the classic, like, human nature. Give me a reason to wait. I'll wait, that's okay. I'm happy to wait. You just told me it's getting better later. I don't have to buy it now.
What, if you could say, what is the most harmful mistake that a founder can make in that startup phase? Mm-hmm. What would you say the most harmful? Just pick two things, because there's probably a difference opinion, but pick two things you think are the most harmful things that you should avoid at all costs, right? Like big X.
Yeah, I think for the founders, we have, I'm going to normalize this. I'm going to say it's only me, because I'm going to give you guys a chance to say, oh, no, I'm going to, it's me too. So founders have this really weird difficulty of separating out the future product at scale and what we have today, right? Because it's my baby, I love it. I've already told you it's my little bird, right? And there's this, you guys know the up and to the right chart, right? So if you're a product vision person and you actually stay on that product vision, you in your head see the product up here to the right. Well, the customer's back here at the launch one, and they only see the features that you have to buy today. And you're like, you go in and out of launch to scale to features and future functions. And in your head, it's all the same. It's a beautiful little bird. And they're looking at it going, I need all these, especially B2B, right? I need all these features in order to buy this. Where in consumer, you can be like, I'm going to ship this, and they could use it today, right? And so I think for founders, the separating out and getting somebody on your team or somebody who's a friend who can say, you're not at scale. I don't know if you guys know this, 90% of startups fail. And that's somewhere between here at launch and up at scale. Because if they're at scale, they already made it.
Yes.
But when you launch and you're like, I have this one feature. And so that's the first one. In your head, you need to separate out those things. The second thing is not going out and talking to enough customers. So in startup land, we call it customer development, right? Customer development is, so I'm doing this class at the UW right now called BYOB, which is basically a workshop for undergrads, and it's build your own business. It's not bring your own bottle. I'm not encouraging alcoholism for the youth. But the question is okay, we meet every 2 weeks, and they get to come in and pitch their idea, and I'm like, okay, so here's the question. If I were you, I'm not telling your idea is bad, but if I were you, here's the question I would want to get answered in the next 2 weeks, and then bring that data back and tell me what they said, right? So who's your customer? How many of you have you talked to? Like face to face. Like I want to see if Andrew's eyes dilate when I say something, right? And if the response is meh, I want to say, well, what would take it from meh to like, I really need that? And be like, meh, tell me more, right? So I'm going to go talk to 25 or 30 customers. By the way, until they write
not
you a
friends.
Check.
Not friends.
Yeah, they're not actually a customer, they're a prospect. So that's another merging of language. If you tell your investor, hey, I've talked to 30 customers. You have 30 customers already? That's amazing. No, I have 30 prospects. Well, what else were you shifting on language about? I'm just saying, right? So go talk to 30 of your customer profile on B2B. If it's B2C, go talk to 50 or 60. What if they steal my idea? No. That is not your problem. Your problem right now is if I talk to 50 people and 40 of them say, I would buy that today, I would spend more time on this idea. And if 10 of them say, meh, and 40 of them go, I would seriously rethink your idea. But if you talk to 25 B2B ones and the IT manager at enterprise companies who do X, Y, and Z, and because you can get introductions to almost all of them through LinkedIn, and go talk to 25 of them. So those are the two big things, right? Separating out the what I have at launch versus scale in my own head as I explain it, not selling too much, right? And then going back and talking to customers and more prospects early, the sooner you do it, the sooner they will prioritize what feature you need to ship. So if this screen goes off, you'll see a photo of a Parker's garage. Is my grandfather's garage in 1911. It was the first Ford garage in southwestern Washington. So Henry Ford had lots of great quotes, by the way. One of the quotes that is misattributed to them is they can have it in any color they want as long as it's black. That he did not say that. By the way, in 1911, there was no interwebs, just so you know. there were lots of car companies, but not lots of car choices. So you kind of got whatever you got at that point in time. You, however, are neither Henry Ford, nor do you live pre-internet, which means the more people you talk to, the better your idea will get. So, and one last point on that. So if Mike and I had the same idea today, and we both were like, this is a kick-ass idea, we're going to go pursue it, but we couldn't decide on 5149, and we're going to go our separate ways. And we went our separate ways, those products would look entirely different a year from now. Oh, yeah. Than they were looking today. They may have had the same nexus, but they're totally different products and totally different companies because of the experience that he has and the experience I have, and we would end up with two totally different products. So is somebody going to steal your idea? Get over it, right? So a good friend of mine, Dan Shapiro, said one time at an event I was doing, people, ideas die from lack of exposure, not from overexposure.
Yeah.
So you need to get out and talk to as many people as you can about your idea.
Yeah.
And hopefully not your friends.
Yeah, not your friends. Not all your mom.
Strangers, complete strangers. So let's open up for questions. She had a question of how to get from 0 to 32. Is that what you think? What was your?
Yeah, how did you go from 0 to 32?
The turning point. So in retrospect, this is before we talked about customer development. So I was in an industry, it was a B2B company. So we did software distribution back in the early days of when people were starting to download software. We did software licenses. So the company that I worked for before was a systems integrator, and we didn't sell software. So I knew the market really well. I went out and did a bunch of research to figure out, is there anybody doing what we were going to do? And then we did the first licensing software delivery model where we would send one CD and 200 licenses. So we were early to that game. So the pivot point was we did a lot of planning. We had to build a set of tools that at the time Microsoft was the biggest product we sold. And everybody we talked to was like, you're going to build a product that Microsoft can't build. And the answer was yes. And people were like, you're nuts. And we're like, no, there's a reason for it. And here's why it's hard. And right. So there was a hard problem. There was a hard technical problem we were trying to solve. And that was the way we started with it. And then we went out. And then I think one of the big pivot points for us was, it's a total growth hack, by the way, is Microsoft had all these regional sales offices. And they were tracked on this one metric that was really hard, which was small business product sales, which we did really well. So we picked the next to the last, the bottom market of their 9 regions. And we just doubled down and invested in that market. And we took that market from, you know, of the 9 regions, they were number 8. And we took them to number 2. And as soon as they hit number 2, all the rest of the markets are like, how the hell did you do that? They're like, oh, we use these guys. And everybody's like, oh, we want you to come to our market. So it was a total way of figuring out what's the growth hack of how do we make this work and focusing in on that one first customer and making sure they were crazy successful so they would be a reference account for us. And B2B, that one was really important. B2C consumer dynamics are totally different. If you're doing a B2C play, the biggest issue there is what's called viral components or what's called K-factor. It's basically there's a math calculation on how do you do K-factor, and that's the ability to refer people to other people. So I'm super geeky about business model stuff that way, though. That's just kind of me. So
questions, guys?
Yeah. I'll let you point. Sorry.
Can't answer. You mentioned that people don't get your idea.
Mm-hmm. Totally. Timing, I think, again, going back to that Bill Gross video on timing, one of the things he talks about, Enrique Gaudreau is a good friend of mine. He started Voyager Capital here years ago, and the day that Uber hit the $1 billion mark, he got a call from a former portfolio company, and they were trying to do something very Uber-esque via text message 8 years earlier.
8 years.
8 years. So 8 years earlier, they had, and Enrique's company had put, I don't know how many millions of dollars into it. I'm sure it was a substantial check. So the guy called him to basically said, see, I told you I was right. And the answer was, you were right. Your timing was just totally wrong. So there's, you seldom get to hit timing perfect, right? So which means you tend to be early or late. And sometimes you can be kind of close. Early is the most expensive option. Because as a visionary entrepreneur,
education,
I believe in my ideas so much that I know the answer is just around the corner. The problem is it's a really long frickin' corner, right? It's one of those that's never actually, you never actually make the bend. So even though my first company got to $32 million, we were still really early in the market. And at 32, we sold to a company that was $1.2 billion, and my next two biggest competitors were $16 billion and $14 billion. Now, we're dancing with gorillas, and if you know the phrase for that, it's like you're not through till he is, right? So the problem of being, though we grew it really fast, it was a really hard market to compete in. So if your timing's super early, you have to recognize as the visionary person, hey, I'm going to park this idea for a while and come back to it at a later date. If you're late, you can try to catch up, right? So being the first follower isn't necessarily a bad thing. Sometimes being the first to market is a really tough thing because you get the market ready and somebody comes along after you with more cash.
Next question. Go ahead.
Great talk, Dave. I cannot agree to a lot of things you just said. My name is Amy. I have two roles, so I have two questions for you. My first role, I am one of the partners for the Grow Up Entrepreneur Community. Here in Seattle, we grew from China with 200,000 women entrepreneurs. So lots to talk to all the ladies here afterwards. So for that, I'd like to understand from your point of view of what do you consider as the biggest challenges for women entrepreneurs here, particularly in Seattle. And if you have seen that and seen successful women entrepreneurs, what would be the advice you have for all of us? So that's my first question.
That's two. Those questions are two. So if nobody else has a question, start with those two. There's still two. So let me answer those two questions first, and if there's nobody else after that, you can ask the third and fourth question.
Thank you.
So, because this is a really hard topic, and I don't want to skim over it. So there's lots of big challenges. I don't know that I could prioritize them for you quite crisply enough. Nationally, 7% of venture capital goes to women entrepreneurs. It's an abysmal number. It has a lot to do with the old boy club network that has to do with venture capital, and Seattle is compounded by the fact there's only three venture capitalists. So Heather Redman's trying to fix that. I love Heather. I would do anything for her. I would say one of the cultural dynamics on both sides, both Chinese and U.S., is that there's so many pieces here. So dudes will say stuff that's not really done yet because they see they will overshoot in their vision for what they want to do, and women will be more pragmatic. So consequently, the ideas look smaller, even though they may not be. So the challenge that is faced then culturally, both on both sides, by the way, I have a Chinese daughter and spent a lot of time in China. I ran a business in China for 4 years. That one was a lot like playing craps. Anybody know how to play craps? I don't. So in China, I would put money down on the craps table equivalent. The money would get vaporized. I'm like, where did that go? It's a hard place to do business, less so if you're Chinese. The outcome of that is I have a 9-year-old Chinese daughter. But that, do you have something to show for it? But it was good. So there's so many dynamics that work against you in so many ways. So I think selling the idea as big enough is really important. Getting traction early, all of the things that were required for any startup to be successful and actually go get funded, that's a big deal, right? And you don't get a hall pass, regardless of gender, on that. So. Then getting to an audience of having some supporters and advisors who can actually help you grow your business and get introduced to the right investors early, I think is really important. So there was an HBS article that just came out. I just posted it on Twitter because somebody sent it to me. Was there's finding men who mentor women is also important. So I think there's lots of opportunities to connect with people. I think Seattle's a great market. If you're a woman entrepreneur who has an idea, I also think that there's times for you to join a company, just like there is, I would tell some guys the same thing, right? So if you have a great idea, awesome, go rock that idea. Make sure it's a big enough idea to get venture backing, because a lot of ideas in Seattle tend to start small, right? And we, so in 1998, when I started my first company, none of this stuff existed, right? So there was no startup ecosystem, right? That's why I run Startup Week still, is because it's a big commitment to the community to have free events and do these things. But none of that existed. So there was a bunch of us looking at, you know, around a table. There was like eight of us, like, well, I don't know, what would you do? I don't know. None of us had done it before, right? There was even less venture capital. So I think from today's perspective, you can get introduced to anybody in town. There's plenty of programs to get plugged into. There's lots of opportunities to networking. Networking's not enough. You need to ship a product. That's super important. Services businesses don't get capital raised. And you need to find people who will mentor you. And I think the nice thing, you know, I was at an event last night with Bob Crimmins, and there's a bunch of us around the table, and some of which you've interviewed before. And, you know, we're having this conversation of how do we continue to lift up, get the community to the next level, right? Who do we grab a hand and bring them to an event? So I think, you know, being engaged with the community is great because you need to be part of the community and get engaged with the community. And then figuring out what events are there to help you, right? There's also some leeches in the market you have to avoid. Yeah? And what I mean by that is there's people who want to raise money for you for a fee. There's people who want to be consultants when you don't have any money for consultants. And you just need to run away from those people. They don't bring any value to your life. There's a group, there's an email listserv that Dan Shapiro started a few years ago called Hassle. It's Help a Seattle Startup. And there was a thread, and it's fairly inactive these days, but basically new founder CEOs can come along and ask questions to old founder CEOs who've raised money and exited. And then somebody's asking the question about, hey, somebody's volunteered, not volunteered, somebody's offered to help me raise money for a fee. It was like the entire, all of us jumped in like, no, do not do that. Just run away. So there's a whole bunch of mistakes that we've made, right? So the scar tissue is still there, but the memory of the pain is still there. But there's a whole bunch of mistakes you don't have to make, and you don't have to go it alone. Seattle's a very collegial town, yeah. Right? Yeah, so. I got to tell you, there's only in the growth companies, for venture-backed growth companies, there's only 17% women on boards.
Wow.
In public companies, it's 20%. One of the big companies here in town had to hire somebody. They went to the Bay to get somebody to bring up to be on their board. The opportunities for you gals is amazing. It is just unbelievably amazing. So 2 years ago, I would have told you it was lip service. But we have 50% women in our classes now at Code Fellows to go get jobs in tech. The women in minorities and veterans get hired at twice the rate.
Yeah.
So we have over 750 grads in market. We have a 92% placement rate at 6 months, 90%+ more at 12 months. Average starting salary is $71,000. On average, it takes somebody 11 weeks after they graduate to get a job, unless you're a woman. In which case, it's 5.5 weeks, which is rocking. That's just amazing, right? So I think that it's actually changed. Now, is it good yet? No, not what I said. It has materially changed and is making good progress. But we need to keep the pedal down on it and keep it working. And I think what you'll find from the ecosystem perspective, there are lots of people who will help you. When you get pushed towards, like, is it a big enough idea? I only have so much time, so every once in a while, I had a friend on the East Coast who I used to work with. And he's like, I'd like to give you 2% to be an advisor on my company. I'm like, no, you can call me anytime. I'm happy to help you. But 2% doesn't move the needle to me to be interesting because I can't do 50 deals at 2%, right? I can't actually help with that. Early stage, I'm happy to help. But I don't actually have to get paid for it if it's later stage. I want you to be successful in Seattle and reinvest in this market. Because if you're here and then you stay here and you reinvest here and you become an angel investor here, that's a huge win.
Everybody wins.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah, you're welcome. So. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, let me repeat that.
Yeah. So I also invest in startups was the question. What do you look for when you invest in startups? My filtering mechanic to do that right now is to invest through Techstars. So, and by the way, if you're a women-led startup and doing a technology company and want to apply for the next, like, I'm easy to find, by the way, online. I'm easy to find. And if you want to get into Techstars, we would love to have you. Finding great teams that are women-led, the math has been... So I'm on the filtering committee, so you can judge me for not... for whatever that is. Of 600 companies who applied for the Techstars Seattle, it's not 50% women companies.
Yeah.
And it's hard to find great companies with traction and product that are women-led. Because if we did, we'd have a lot more of them in there. So if you have an idea and you want to get in Techstars, so Techstars is the way I invest right now. So I invest in the Techstars fund. I mentor those companies. And if there's companies in that portfolio I want to invest in, I'll work on doubling down and investing in that fund. But that's kind of my arbitrage strategy because it's hard to pick winners. That's why I'm an I'm not a VC. I'm an entrepreneur. And I fall in love with ideas and teams, and that makes me very not objective about my investment strategy, which, by the way, is a bad investment strategy, just in case you're wondering. You're like, that may be a good bad investment strategy.
Hey. What are your thoughts about hiring family members for a
startup? Wow.
So I've been married for 29 years. We're partners in our LLC, which is the investment fund that we invest in together. We occasionally work together. It's a unique couple that can do that. From a family member perspective, as long as your business plans on never taking outside capital, I think as long as you have a good dynamic and have some of those things worked out in advance, I think it's okay. If, however, you plan on ever taking outside capital, I would say it's a non-starter. There are so many things working against you when you're taking outside capital anyway, that's just one of those things that causes a what, right? And if you don't, by the way, if you can bootstrap a company and never take outside capital,
do that,
like every day, right? Because then at some point you're like, I have a board member and they're kind of an asshole, and I don't want to, like, we should go on a trip and pay for, like, oh, there's a whole bunch of things that just change when you take outside capital. You now have shareholders, and you have a fiduciary duty to the shareholders. Versus if it's you're the shareholder, you're like, I have a shareholder. I like this idea, right? And it just, there's a whole bunch of latitude difference. So if you ever plan on taking outside money, I would say it's kind of a non-starter, regretfully. Culturally, we just don't seem to do it, and investors kind of look at it and go, it's just a little too quirky. It's one more dynamic that gets me, I'm not sure.
It's pretty rare.
Eventbrite did it. It's amazing, right? But the number of companies that are venture-backed with, family members is really tough.
One more question, guys. No more questions? Okay.
It's a one-part question.
I'm glad I get to ask my second question. So you guys really need to Your third question. More this time.
Third question.
The question is, as a co-founder of a information platform, we're trying to connect startups with investors directly across or avoiding having to pay a fee, either both in Seattle, in the States, and internationally.
Okay.
The question is, go ahead.
No, I just don't want you to sell your product. I'm happy to get your question, but the promotion of the product is a bummer, and it distracts from the question.
That's why you don't disclose the name of it, right? The question is, as a platform like this, we can offer a premium model or paid model. Because you mentioned earlier, you're a geek of business models. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to understand a little bit more about your take on premium specifically.
Okay, so a couple things. So if you're doing a consumer product, you can do what's called freemium. Freemium is basically a de-featured version of your product that you can let people have for free, and then they have to upgrade to get something more. Or better yet, if it's games, you can sell them virtual swords for amazing profits. If you have a choice, go that direction. Just if you're B2B, you can do a time-based version, but typically early versions of products like that on a business-to-business perspective, there's no way to de-feature them and have them be worth anything. So you're like, I have three features. I've taken two of the features out so you can have the free version. It's like, okay, well, you kind of gutted the product, right? So from a B2B perspective, that's a bummer. As an investor, I would never use it. So, and I would look at AngelList as a comp and decide whether it's really worthwhile in pursuing. And the reason is because I don't invest in deals outside of my territory. I want to be able to look at you and go, how's it going? How's your team doing?
Which
is true with most
do
angels.
You have and most VCs. Most VCs don't want to get on a plane. So to invest in something that there's no due diligence in, so I've worked on corporate VC, regular VC, and angel investors. The syndication that AngelList put together was really great in the Valley. But if you look at the density of it outside of the Valley, not so much. Right? So I think from a business model perspective, you have to do, that's a marketplace as a business model. I've written a lot about, so there's 9 business models. My blog is dkparker.com. I get paid so much when you read my blog. I'd really like to sell my product to you. So there's marketplaces are one of the 9 business models. The tough things about marketplaces is you have to get product market fit right on both sides. It's really hard. If you get it, you can create a bigger product, a bigger market than existed before. Uber is an example, right? Because that market didn't exist that way before. They created a bigger market than actually existed. So if you do marketplaces right, you can do that. So marketplaces are hard because you have to have a full product suite and you have to have product market fit on both sides. So they're hard. So that's 1 of the 9, right? I tend to lean towards subscription model early versus service models. I run a services business now, which I always kind of scratch my head and go, again? So by the way, if people are thinking about doing a startup, you haven't decided yet on a startup, you're working on a startup, some of you? Okay. All right, so here's a pop quiz for you, and then we'll be done. If you sell a services business, what multiple of revenue will it sell for on average? So 1 to 3,
0.9,
up to 6 from the accounting firm. Depends a lot on the business, but on services perspective, if you have a services business where people are required to deliver the product that you're selling, 0.9 to 6 is pretty generally the case. So if you're doing $1 million in revenue, the business will sell for $900,000 to $6 million, depending on what type of business it is, how good your customer base is. What's the multiple on a recurring revenue SaaS software business?
5 to 10.
Any other guesses? Up to 12 or 14. So if you have $1 million business on a recurring software as a services business that is going to sell, it could sell for up to $12 million. Now, how much work is it to build $1 million business? A lot. Is it a lot more different for a product than a services business? Not a hell of a lot. So if you haven't decided to do a services business yet, I'm just saying, you may want to consider doing a product business. It's not that services businesses are bad. They're just harder to do, right? Because you need people, and every time you get a new client, you have to add more people, and you may have good methodology. Good methodology helps you to get to the multiple of 6. Bad methodology throws people at stuff, which helps you get the multiple of 0.9. But product with recurring revenue and predictability. So the more recurring revenue you can do, so anybody reads Tomas Tongas's, anybody know Tomas Tongas, Redpoint Ventures? Best, if you have a SaaS company and you're doing recurring revenue SaaS business, read Tomas Tongas's blog. He's brilliant. He's the next Google guy, and his metrics are amazing.
All the clues to watch.
So then again, there's a little bit of advice for you. If you haven't decided on your startup yet and there's still time to pick, go with product. But you choose. Uber at launch and at scale, Uber is different business models, and it's a great point as well. Thanks for asking it, because again, as a founder, we tend to think of our business up here at scale, and we're like, we have 6 business models. Not at launch, you don't. At launch, you get 1, and you better get it right, because if you're wrong, you don't have enough runway to get to the second one. So Uber at scale is a marketplace that also manages transaction fees, right? So, but from a marketplace perspective, they own both sides of that marketplace, very much like Airbnb. And at Airbnb at scale, they get transaction fees and subscription fees. But at launch, it was only a marketplace. So I have buyers, I have sellers, I'm doing the matching process, and that's the definition of that. But at scale, you have choices. You have a bunch of different business models you can do at scale, but not at launch.
So at launch, you got to sign one.
At launch, you got to pick, and pick wisely.
Yes, because you don't have much time to fail at that one and choose the next one. Well, thank you guys for being here.